Hi, I hope everyone can hear me. A very good evening to all of you. Hope everyone is keeping safe and sound and abiding by the health advisories issued to us. I would also like to take this opportunity to remind you to save a thought for the lesser privileged and do your bit to stand by them in this moment of crisis. These are indeed trying times and we will overcome it together. Moving on to some positivity, on behalf of Prabha Khaitan Foundation, I welcome you to the online closed-door session curated for our SAS women to interact with the actor, director, and also an author now, Nandita Das. She is a strong advocate for social issues of social justice and human rights. Ms. Das has acted in more than 40 feature films in 10 different languages. She made her directorial debut with Firaq in 2008, which premiered at the Toronto Film Festival, winning her many accolades and appreciation. Her second directorial venture, Manto, was another landmark film that made it to Cannes Film Festival, followed by huge national appreciation. Ms. Das has recently authored a book titled Manto and I, which is about her six-year journey studying short story writer and the emotional, political, and spiritual experiences she underwent throughout the study and the filming. It is a matter of great privilege that we have with us this ever-talented lady. The first 20 minutes, Ms. Das will speak to you all, after which she will address your questions. Please click on the raise your hand option on your screen if you have a question. We will try our best to incorporate as many questions as possible and work on putting your audio and video on air as well. Keeping in mind the load on services providers, do bear with us just in case there are any technical glitches. Without much ado, I'm just going to put Nandita live. Hi.
Hi, I'm Anisha, and hi, everyone. I don't know if you can see me. Can you? Can you hear me? Can you see me?
Yeah, I'm sure they can.
Okay, just to make sure. Well, technology does connect us even in these times. So thank you all for coming this afternoon. And, you know, in some ways we are connected through this huge crisis where our abuse of nature, we are getting a befitting response for it. But hopefully we shall learn our lesson and we'll be out of this soon. So Manisha, should I continue?
Yes, please. You can share my part.
Yes. Okay, you know, usually these kind of calls, you also see other people, so you feel more connected. But okay, I'm going to talk into this black hole for now. Some of you might have seen, some of you haven't, some of you might have at least heard of the film Manto, which is my second directorial film, which is based on the life and works of Saadat Hasan Manto, a short story writer, who was really ahead of his times. He was extremely sensitive, especially to issues of women. He was a true free-spirited man who believed that everything that exists must be talked about, that reality must reflect in our art, in our literature. There's no reason to hide it. So he was a real champion of truth in that sense. I often, in fact, use the word mantoyat. And one of the reasons why I made the film was to invoke that mantoyat in all of us. Because I do believe that all of us want to be more honest. We want to be more courageous. We want to be more free-spirited. So in that sense, Manto is a true inspiration for me and I hope for many. After doing the film, it was a long 6-year journey. Right from the inception of thinking about the idea, researching. I didn't grow up in an Urdu-speaking family, though some of his works are translated, but you know, many of the English translations weren't good. So I had to read it in Devanagari, and you know, we don't end up reading as much Hindi as we should. So it was a bit of a challenge. And then also we just had about 10, 14, 15 photographs. So how do you build a character? How do you build that world and create those times? So there was a lot of archival footage. I went to Lahore to meet his family, his three daughters, his sister-in-law especially, who gave me a lot of interesting trivia, anecdotes, shared with me stories, not just about Manto, but about his wife. Because about Safia, Manto's wife, not much was written. So really to create her character was quite a challenge. In some ways, I could take more liberties because there wasn't that much documented, unlike Manto, because he he was so prolific that he had written so much that in some ways, if you read a lot of Manto, you kind of know him. You kind of almost understand not just his concerns, but the kind of person he was. And then collecting the crew, cast, you know. So the whole process was very long and exhausting, challenging, but also immensely interesting, exciting, a huge learning curve in my life. So then I did a book. The book was like everything else in my life was not planned. But once I finished the film, I've got the book here. I hope some of you will get it or see it. I don't know if you can see it. It's called Manto and I. And it's got lots of photographs, like you see, you know, in the process of making the film. It's it talks about many different things, right from who Manto was to the kind of atmosphere we created, the kind of locations. For instance, what kind of house did he have? Who were the characters? So it's really, as you can see, it's a big, heavy coffee table book, because it's got more than 100 photographs and chapters on every aspect of it. I thought, considering you're all women, we all are struggling in our own ways as women, you know, battling with our own sense of guilt, how we end up taking the shorter end of the stick, trying to sometimes figure out, are we really less confident, or is it something that we have just internalized over the years? What choices are we making? Are we being questioned about those choices all the time? If we are a stay-home person, then are we being told, why aren't you working? If we are working, are we being told, why are you neglecting family? Are we having to answer more questions than, you know, than definitely most men? And while I'm a big champion of multiple identities, I believe we are no one identity. You know, we are many things: our nationality, the color of our skin, the language we speak, what we like to eat, our gender, our race, everything together makes us who we are. And not just the given identities that we are just born in. We've done nothing to be a woman or to be an Indian or to be born in a certain caste or religion or whatever. But ideally, we want to be defined by our thoughts, our feelings, our actions, our attitudes, our behavior. But often that doesn't happen. And while I champion multiple identities, I realize that in my own life, the identity of the woman has always taken precedence over other identities. And I've asked myself that why is that the case? And I feel it's because I'm never allowed to forget that I'm a woman. For better or for worse, I'm constantly reminded in more than one ways that I'm a woman. And that kind of puts a certain amount of burden, you know, what work you do, how you look, what are the expectations of you, what expectations you create of yourself. So it's quite a balancing act in many ways that one has to constantly do. And that's why I myself was intrigued by, like, a lot of people ask me, why Manto? Why not a woman writer? Why not a woman protagonist? And I always have felt that at some level, our feminist movement has also failed because we haven't engaged enough with men. We haven't celebrated the few good men who are championing issues of women, who are not just championing, but actually understand what we go through or see us really at par. And Manto was definitely one of those. I mean, he was a true feminist. He would have hated labels, as most of us do. I do. But I think he was a true feminist. He not only wrote extensively about women, more about those who were on the margins of society, like sex workers, but also in his own life, his relationship with his wife was really like a true friend, like a comrade. You know, and even though he didn't write much about her, because he always said, I'm not interested in the homemakers enough. I want, you know, he was edgy, he was provocative. So he preferred to write about those women who nobody was writing about. But he would braid his hair, her hair. He would iron her saris. He would cook. He would take care of the children. He would do many things that even today's modern day men don't do. So he was a feminist in many ways. And also in the film, those of you who have seen will see that his wife gets, you know, as much prominence, as much empathy. Sometimes, in fact, you empathize more with the wife than even Manto. So I've not put him on a pedestal and said, okay, he was all great. It was important that the journey of the wife of Safiya is also shown as responsibly, as empathetically, because living with a man like Manto, who was such a maverick, who became an alcoholic by the end of it, who every time he spoke and wrote something that was really cutting edge, something that we celebrate today, but at that time was termed as being obscene. And he would, you know, cases would be slapped on him. He was, you know, he was tried for six stories, what called obscene stories. And thankfully, he wasn't really convicted in any of them. He was very close to conviction. And then there were appeals made and he always managed to get out of it. But it did take a toll on his family. And that's why I probably took the liberty of even making his wife more feisty than she really was. When I went to meet the family, they all said she was very sweet, very soft-spoken, very gentle, very supportive. And I thought to myself, a woman who's living with this man, this kind of a person, it couldn't have been that easy. There must have been more to it. And when I started scratching the surface, I think I did find some clues to say that while she didn't articulate, while she didn't say that, she was definitely, you know, inside she was pained, she was suffering, she was angry, she was frustrated, like any person would be. And so I definitely made her feistier, gave her more agency. And I was very happy that when the daughters came to India and they saw the film, they really liked the way their mother was portrayed, because at some level, I think they also felt that their mother was wrong and never really talked about enough. The other thing I wanted to really talk about is this whole tag of being a woman director. You know, when I did Firaq, my first film in 2008, I was on many panels where people would ask me, what is it to be a woman director? And I used to hate that label. I used to sort of go and argue against it and say, you know, I'm a director. When I work, I'm not thinking that I'm a woman. I'm just doing my work. And why do I have to be burdened by this label? I mean, why can't I be seen as a director? You don't call the, you know, the other male directors as a male director. You just call them directors. So why this tag on us? 10 years later, when I did Manto, and the conversation still hasn't changed, we're still talking about, you know, less, and the fact that there are less women directors, well, more than last what they were 10 years ago, but still, you know, very few. It's in single digits, if you really count. And but my relationship with the tag has changed. And I'll tell you why. It's because now when people say, so how does it feel, you know, to be a woman director? 10 years ago, my answer would be, I don't know how it feels to be a male director. But today, I've kind of embraced that tag, because I feel that if we are all saying that we want more women directors, we first have to accept our own label. We first have to accept that, yes, I'm a woman director, and I want more of us. I want more of us telling our stories, because I want more diversity in the stories that we tell. I want to be, you know, I want to hear different perspectives. And not that every woman director is going to tell us the best story, or every male director tells us terrible stories. After all, much of the stories about women that we have seen have been told by men, whether it's, you know, Satyajit Ray, whether it's Shyam Benegal, whether it is Mrinal Sen, you know, a whole lot of directors who have actually focused on issues of women have also been men, but that's because men dominated the scene. There are certain experiences that we as women go through, and they are unique to us, and we don't have to be aware of it when we are working. It's just part of us. It's part of our experiential understanding of life, of things, of people. And therefore, I think I'm much more comfortable with that tag, at least till a time when there are more women behind the camera telling their stories. And then we can abandon this tag, and hopefully nobody then will ask whether, you know, you're a woman director or a male director, etc. Those binaries will end. And connected to that is this whole idea of the female gaze. Is there really a female gaze? You know, I definitely feel there are films that I have watched and I have felt there is a deep presence of a male gaze. I feel that, yeah, this film could have been made only by a man. The way certain scenes are handled, the way women are represented, whether it's in terms of objectification of women, whether it's the way how violence is handled, how sexuality is handled. A lot of the times you feel that, and sometimes you see a film and you feel that presence of a female gaze. So it's not a very conscious thing, but like I said earlier, I think those experiences that we have do give us a different perspective, and you know, and that's why we do want more female gaze. Although a writer like Manto, I would say he had a female gaze too. I mean, the way he understood women and the way he wrote about them without pity and without sympathy, but actually an understanding and, you know, seeing them with their strengths and vulnerabilities, I felt like he almost had a female gaze. So a man can also have a female gaze, but largely I think we women definitely need those opportunities that men sort of are so entitled to in telling our stories. I better also look at the time because I could go on. Okay, I have a few more minutes. The other thing as a woman director, I mean, why are there less of us? One, of course, the fact that, you know, this has been a male-dominated industry. It's not been easy for women to come in. And when they have come in, we've been asked, oh, can you do night shoots? Will you be able to do this? You know, sometimes women are misbehaved with, as we know from the Me Too movement. There were a lot of stories that came out of the film sets. But more importantly, I think we just don't get those opportunities to reach till there. We don't, you know, now there are more and more women who are going to film schools, but there was a time that there was a minuscule percentage of women in film schools or on film sets. So therefore it was not an option that women even explored. Even families were very apprehensive that, oh, how are you going to manage night shoots, you travel to different parts. A lot of the times we were just questioned whether we can do it or not. Once women started doing it, of course those things change. But the other big hurdle often happens is that when women get married and they have children, like I had, my son was 2 years old when I actually started working on Manto. So for me, in many ways, you know, Manto and my son, they've had sort of parallel journeys. My son was 2, and by the time the film really ended was 8. So those 6 years, you know, he was pretty much growing up with my work with Manto. And we do find it difficult to juggle. You know, men go to work and men come back home. I'm generalizing, but largely they're able to compartmentalize. Whereas we women always have something at the back of our mind that, oh, we have to do this, we have to take care of this at home, we have to do this for the child, we have to do this for our family. And you can say, well, we are nurturers, you know, we are meant to do that. But I think a lot of it is just not the nature that we are inborn with, the feminine side, but also how we are brought up. We are brought up to multitask. We are praised for it. I, in fact, don't want that compliment at all, because I would much rather focus on one thing at a time. But it does get very tiring when you're having to do two things, and seldom do we get that kind of a support system where, you know, the men take part in that sharing of the work, as women constantly do that. That's why they say behind every successful man, you know, there is a woman, and behind every successful woman, it is she. And this cliche is actually pretty true for many women and many men. And that's why that was one thing that I also juggled hugely with, in trying to take care of my child, and, you know, whether it was the editing process, whether it was looking for locations, whether it was the actual shoot. I remember the first day of the shoot in 45 degrees, we were in a small village in Gujarat. I was shooting with Gurdas Manji, and he, and there were 250 villagers who were doubling up as junior artists. And here was this child tugging at me, at my waist, while I was trying to, you know, do this shot. So those kind of jugglings that women end up doing does take a toll on us. And that will only change when men start taking a greater care in sharing the work. We still call them supportive, but hopefully there will be a time where these you know, men and women's fixed roles would not be there. I think I have done my 20 minutes. And I would very much welcome your questions, your thoughts, your comments, and let's have a truly open conversation. Sometimes it's lovely when there are only women, no hold bars. And so, yeah, even if you disagree with me, I'd be very happy to hear your point of view.
Okay, great. I'm just putting one of our attendees.
Okay.
I hope you can see her.
Yeah. Hey, I'm going to wear my glasses because I see better with my glasses. There you go. You two are with glasses, so you know what that feels like.
Yeah. Hi. Good afternoon. Amazing 20 minutes. And congratulations on Manto. I watched this film very randomly because honestly, unfortunately, I didn't know much about Manto before your movie.
Okay. I've introduced Manto to a lot of people, so I'm quite happy about that.
And Manto didn't leave me for about, I think, a few days, not hours. And that was a one time my mind and my heart totally was in tandem. And I was like, where are these Mantos now? I want to ask you two things. This, did you have this Manto earth in you forever that made you meet Firaq? Because Firaq is again like communal and Manto is also pretty... And so did that Manto earth in you made you make the movie Firaq? And why do you think there are no Mantos now?
Well, to answer the last question first, there are Mantos now. Some we know, some we don't know. I mean, they're maybe away from media glare, but who is a Manto? Manto is a person, like I said, who has, you know, who wants to speak out, who has the courage of conviction, who is free-spirited, who is not bound by the diktas and, you know, log kya kahenge kind of a pressure, who just has deep convictions and is driven by that. So I think there are Mantos. Some have been killed, some are in jail, some are still fighting the battles for many of us. So I think there are, and I guess I did have Manto earth, and I owe that to my father, really, who was the Manto in my life in many ways. He was a maverick, he's an artist, but very Manto-like. I mean, I think that's why I could also make the film, because in many ways I felt like I understood my father better because of Manto after the film, but I felt like I could do the film because I grew up with a person like that, you know, who didn't care about money, who spoke as he felt, who was therefore misunderstood, sometimes to the point of being rude, but, you know, was just genuine to the core. And I think just growing up with someone like that, some of it just percolates down and you kind of have... Manto has been such an inspiration, and these 6 years being with Manto, you know, in some ways has made me, in fact, stronger in that sense in terms of my own convictions.
So I why isn't Nike not in a bigger commercial? Because that's a need of the time. Manto is wanted right now. I mean, right before that.
Thank you. It's on Netflix. That's the good part that it's on Netflix. Yeah. But these kind of films always, it's very difficult to release. And I've written about that extensively in the book. I've in fact made quite a case for independent filmmakers at large, not just for me and Manto, but just largely what are the challenges we face when we do a film like this? And then when you get very few screenings, you get very few theaters, then you get something at 9 a.m. in the morning, 11 at night in a far off theater, how do you expect people to watch it? The marketing is very minimal, unlike, you know, most mainstream films. So if you say, let's say A Thug of Hindustan got 5,000 screens and Manto got 500. So what do you do with that? You know, Manto wasn't even in the first week in Amritsar, which is his own city, where people were waiting, where everybody knew of Manto. There was not a single screen there, you know, or Kerala, which is a very cinema literate state. And a lot of the people know about Manto, but there was not a single screening. So some of these things are really beyond one's control, unfortunately.
Amazing, the next movie.
It's on Netflix, so you can watch it. Those of you.
I watched it and I shared it, and everybody liked it. But none of us were aware of this movie
when it came, when it went. But you know, thankfully, a lot of people, even till date, somebody or the other is watching it somewhere in some part of the world and is writing to me. So that.
And also for us, I think. The people who didn't know much about Manto, I think our picture of Manto will always be Nawazuddin for a while. He was too good.
Yeah, he's a wonderful actor. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
We'll just move on to the next question,
please. Sure.
Yeah. How do you go about this? Yeah, so we have Kanakshi here. Kanakshi, can you please start your video? Kanakshi, can you hear us? Yeah, great.
Yeah, I can. Can you hear me?
Yes, I
can. Hello. Nandita ji, yeah. I'm here from Lucknow.
Hi, hi. Very nice meeting you. E-meeting you, Zoom meeting you.
Yes. My question to you would be, how do you think religion impacts filmmaking and arts in the wider sense? Do you think being an atheist has helped you develop a better understanding?
Sorry, what has helped me? Say that again.
Being an atheist, I was going through your biography. I realized that for most of your life, probably even now, you are more of an atheist than a believer, if I may say so. So does it help you develop a better critical understanding of human condition, which reflects in your work, say, in Firaq?
Your first question was something else, right? It was about how does art...
I said, how do you think religion...
How does film...
Religion impacts filmmaking.
How does religion impact filmmaking? Okay.
They connect. There is something like religion, there's something being a believer or a non-believer. So I thought...
Well, it's such a personal choice. I mean, now, unfortunately, religion has come out so much in the public space. In fact, Manto ki ek bahut achhi line hai. Wo, you know, during the communal strife, during partition, he got two topis, one Hindu topi and a Muslim topi. And considering he was an atheist himself and never did namaz, never practiced, you know, never went to the mosque ever, etc. Somebody asked him that, why do you have two topis, a Hindu topi and a Muslim topi? After ek bhi nahi pehante, aapne do rakhi hai. तो उनका ये जवाब था कि जब मजहब दिलों से चढ़कर सर पे दिलों से उतर कर सर पे चढ़ जाए तो टोपियां पहननी पड़ती हैं. यानी मजहब तो ऐसी चीज है विच शुड बी इन द हार्ट. इफ यू हैव अ पर्टिकुलर फेथ, समबडी एल्स हैज अ डिफरेंट फेथ, आई कैन हैव अ डिफरेंट फेथ, दैट्स अ वेरी पर्सनल थिंग. हूएवर आई एम, माई लाइफ एक्सपीरियंसेस आर बाउंड टू इन्फॉर्म एंड बाउंड टू इम्पैक्ट माई आर्ट, राइट? फाइनली इवन माई how I have interpreted, let's say, Manto is my interpretation. It's a subjective view. I cannot say anybody who would have done it the same way. Now, if I'm not religious, then I'm sure that is also one aspect of it that impacts how I look at characters. Luckily, yes. He also wasn't, so I wasn't compromising on that, or I wasn't trying to. But if he was, I would have shown that. I don't think I've shown a scene in the graveyard where, you know, he's praying for his mother, and then of course he makes a very sort of audacious statement that under mounds of earth Manto is buried, and he's thinking, yes, who's a greater writer, Manto or him, you know? He's also kind of being irreverent.
Yes.
So I do believe that there is a greater force, and I think this coronavirus has proved it to us that it is nature. For me, nature is my only god. You know, I think it, because I don't understand things about nature. Nature, hum God ko sochte hain jo humse badhkar hai, humse upar hai, jinko hum nahi samajh sakte, lekin wo hume samajhte hain. So I think nature for me is God, and if different people have their own faiths, I'm very respectful of it. But I personally don't. I don't have any, you know, statue or whatever.
Manto ka sawal hai, wo bhi Pakistan gaye, to isliye nahi gaye ki unhe bahut mohabbat thi.
Bilkul bhi nahi.
इसलिए कि वो शायद more out of fear than anything else.
Well, not all. I think it was out of betrayal. Have you seen the film?
Yes.
Kanak, have you seen the? Okay, so if you see the reason, it was more a sense of betrayal. जब अपने जब दगा दे देते हैं, उसका जो एक दुख होता है ना, that is a very special kind of. So there were times of fear, and there was a certain sense of fear, but that wasn't the reason why he left. He was able to combat that situation till he felt that my closest friend is seeing me through a lens that I don't see myself. If I don't see myself in terms of my religion, but if my closest Hindu friend sees me as that, phir kya rakha hai mera is mulk mein? That's the reason. And I think he still regretted it, because he was much in love with Bombay, and he, you know, saw, he related to not just India but Bombay particularly, but India much more. He lived 3/4 of his life here after all.
और वो एंग्स्ट आपकी फिल्म में बहुत अच्छी तरह से आई है, जो मतों के अंदर जो एंग्स्ट
जी, it's a very deep pain and you know you
even
Firaz, and you have to be very sensitive. You have to be very sensitive to feel that pain. And even as an audience, I think when people tell me about my film, I think they tell me more about themselves than the film. Film to khair jo hai, achhi buri jo bhi hai, but I feel like I get to know more about what people are feeling.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay, so we move on to the next question. I request everyone to keep their questions small, please, because there are a lot of them and we are running a little short of time here. So we have Preeti here. Preeti, can you? We can hear you. Can you see us?
Hi, Preeti.
Hello.
Hi.
Yeah. Hi.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi, Nandita.
Hi.
Two, three things. I really liked listening to you, first of all. I just wanted to say two or three things. I've basically been working in publishing, mainly feminist press. And so I really enjoyed, of course, Manto I know about, have read copiously all, you know, for years and years. But also watching your film, because you made the stories and his life sort of seamlessly come together and asked a lot of really interesting questions. And then, of course, the fact that I am partly from Amritsar, also from a partition family. So all of that adds a lot of dimension, many more layers to your own viewing of this film.
Absolutely.
I know your mother a little bit. I've met your dad once. But other than that, I liked what you said about the female gaze. And I feel that for a woman director looking at a subject like this, because so much of Manto and so many of his stories are to do with marginalized people who have possibly been voiceless. I think you, as a woman director and as a woman, actually you have an empathy which actually adds a lot more than I would imagine a man to be able to do. That is just, I mean, that's not a question, that's just a comment. And the fact that there is this very edgy, as you said, maverick, very attractive man with these ideas.
Thank you.
I can see the Manto Yath, of course, as a very, very attractive thing. It's attractive in you. It's attractive even otherwise in anybody that I can, you know, I really relate to that thing. And it's required even more today than ever before in many ways. Anyway, because I've been working on marginalized voices and have been in a feminist press, maybe this is the question that I want to ask, which is how do we push a positive and progressive narrative into popular and mainstream media and entertainment? I know this is something which is extremely important. It's very important for me when I try and sell books. I think it's very important when we do this, whether it's with media as far as news stories are concerned, and certainly with entertainment. How do we push it? How do we get this narrative there in the most entertaining manner, yes, but not to lose the message, the thing that is the most important, in my opinion.
No, you're absolutely right. And, you know, we can be doing whatever we do, but if you're on the sidelines, it's not going to have that kind of impact that, let's say, a more mainstream film has. But, you know, you can't have it all, in the sense that mainstream, by its very definition, is trying to please a lot of people. You know, mainstream's main agenda is box office. So they treat the film also like a science. Ek chamach ye hona chahiye, ek chamach ye hona chahiye. You know, what is the audience want? They do these target, you know, they give questionnaires to a target audience. They see how they have responded. They even change the ending. They do things dependent on just a small amount of sample, you know. And so those are the challenges. Sometimes in mainstream cinema, there have been women-centric films that are actually very unfeminist, you know, in the sense they're very sexist. Just having a woman at the center of the film doesn't make it a feminist film. In fact, we would want how women are represented, even in the smallest of roles, you know, is there an understanding of those characters? Are women as layered as, are they as interesting as the male characters are? That is what we would really want, not just women-centric. Of course, it would be good to have that too. But even in terms of, like, even if I'm wondering, the fact that men have dominated the narrative for so long, how we want to see men, how we want to see women, how we want to see violence, how we want to see different predicaments have been dominated by men. So even if I do a story about a man, or I do a story about war, I do a story about communal strife, the gaze will be of a female. There is a female gaze to all of that. And women get impacted by everything. So one, I feel like, you know, I have to also do what I believe in. I can't make a film that maybe a very popular filmmaker does, because he's or her, she's doing it through their sensibilities. I can't be copying. You have to, your voice has to be an honest voice from within. And if we try to make everything too popular, we might miss the nuances. Because in popular cinema, there are more binaries. You know, that is the first casualty, is nuances. And if we only see number of people, I mean, you know, all you or Manisha or whoever has spoken, you know, just now, Priyanka and, you know, Kanak, these are viewers too. Why are we any less than what we call, you know, the more mainstream audience? Also, films like Manto don't reach the masses. And we sometimes in arrogance feel that these are films for classes. But I feel that if there was a way, if the marketing and distribution was better with more faith, then these kind of films would also reach the masses. And, you know, they may not intellectualize it, but they watch films with their heart and they understand. I mean, my own driver, you know, he saw the first screening when I showed it to the cast and crew. And his response was as candid and as beautiful and as exact as what, as a director, I wanted my audience to feel. So, because if by that logic, there would never be any documentaries, because documentaries are watched even less than the ones I make or a few others do. You know, so yeah, I think we all have to play our part and hope that the system would be such, and I think audience can break it too. If audiences support films like this, because it is finally a demand and supply. And if there is more demand, I think the producer, distributor nexus will start understanding and showing our films.
But I think there has to also be like an awareness, or kind of an education, if you want to call it that. So if you already have a little bit of that, then it's easier for you to connect.
I think that kind of exposure, yeah. And I think with all these digital medium, people are getting exposed to a lot more films than the typical mainstream cinema, which is also not working all the time. So. Thank you, Preeti.
No, I agree. I think that you need that, you know, that sort of sediment of at least knowing what it is that you're getting into before. So even with your driver or with, you know, somebody who works in my house, if I have already talked to them about certain issues, or at least told them about the four different engaged ways of looking at one thing. Then it matters.
But art and cinema is not in our schools. Art is seen as a co-curricular thing. You know, we have never given art, music, aesthetics the same empathy. Forget about that. Just empathy, to put that in the center of education. You know, we have put science and maths and
I agree. English in the center. I mean, that's like...
So the kind of world we will make. And that's where we have
and actually, and that's this why really this teaches pandemic. You what life is. And it's not, it's not the science and the maths, but it's, you know, watching something like this, which actually educates. Yeah, makes you know.
Thank you.
So we move on to the next question, please. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, Minister?
I'm trying to put people on loud, but that's not working. Yeah, so someone here.
Dimple. I can see the name before the face.
Dimple ji, can you hear us?
Yes.
Dimple ji, we can't see you, but you please turn on the video. Yeah.
Yeah. Hello.
Hi.
Nandita,
yeah, hello.
Appreciate Manto.
Thank you.
It was a big surprise. And jab se trailer dekha tha, I really want to watch that film. Beautiful film.
Shukriya.
With crisp editing and background music was too good. So just to say
thank you.
And a lot of appreciation for your film. And definitely I want to read that book. Thank you.
Thank you. I hope you do. It's called Manto and I, so it's as much about Manto as my
definitely
own journey with him.
Thank you.
Shukriya. Thank you.
Thank you.
Congratulations for your.
I'll just put on the next question.
Sure.
Nidhi, can you hear us?
Yeah, I can.
Anything? Yes.
Can you see me? I can see the bulge.
The light.
Main kya karu?
I.
This is.
Yeah.
Can you see me?
Nidhi, you need to change to.
You all ulta. Doesn't matter, I can still hear you clearly.
Or I can just go on my mobile. Can you see me? I can't see anything.
Sure. I can see you upside.
Actually, I guess your network's really low. We'll just put someone else.
Ab band karke nahi aap audio se baat kar lijiye. Can you see us though? Yeah. Okay.
I'll just put someone else here and then maybe we can get you back in.
Okay,
sure.
I've also got questions on the chat. Are you also seeing it, Manisha?
Yeah, I can see them.
Okay, then you're fine.
Yeah, so we have Ridhima here, she's from Udaipur.
Yeah, hi Ridhima.
Hi Nandita, it was an amazing session and congratulations on
Thank
your
movie.
And of course, the book.
Thank you.
I love the point when you spoke about the women gaze. And my question is, if there was any story that you wanted to retell, rewrite, or a movie you wanted to redirect in your own way, in your women's gaze, which one would that be? Which piece of work would that be? And how would you change it?
Oh, I don't know. It's tough to say because I've never really thought about taking someone's work and, you know, sort of, there are many stories to tell, but this is one of the many that comes, just flashes in my mind, is Paroma of Aparna Sen, which is about a woman sort of getting out of marriage. And I've always been intrigued by this whole institution of marriage and separation. And, you know, I've gone through it myself. And I'm just sort of how women find themselves in marriages and, you know, what all that they navigate through is something that definitely is of interest to me. So whether it's Satyajit Ray's Ghare Baire, whether it is Aparna Sen's Paroma, you know, whether it is Mahesh Bhatt's Arth, there are many films that deal with, you know, whether it was Hrishikesh Mukherjee's Andhi, films that deal with relationships, you know, when two people come together and they fall in love and they want to be together, and then something starts happening, and what is that, and how do women process it? And I think it's a very unique way in which women process it and the way men process it.
Correct.
And that tension, and I think women are more and more asking questions. They're more and more saying, hello, why do we have to go through this? Why can't I do this? Why can't, you know, why am I expected to do this? Suddenly we are seeing ourselves as human beings.
Right.
Not just as women. And I think that is changing the equation, that is kind of ruffling too many feathers, and we are sort of in transition to understand the institution of marriage. So
exactly.
I don't know, that's been something that has been on my mind, something that I want to tackle at some point.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Thank
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, so this will be the last question that we'll take because we're running out of time. So we have Shweta here. Shweta, can you hear us? Shweta, hi.
Yeah, hi.
Hi.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good, Shweta. Can't see you yet.
Yeah.
We have to do switch.
Never mind, you can just ask the question.
Yeah.
Start with.
Yeah, Shweta.
Yeah, I think I'm right. Yeah, hi. First of all, a big congratulations to you for this wonderful book.
Thank
and
you.
Movie.
Thank you.
So, I feel Manchu is not just a celebration of the man or the writer, but the idea of Manoyat. Mantoyat,
ji.
Yeah. So, could you just tell us something about this?
Do you have the book in front? Is that what you're looking at?
No, I have read about it.
Oh, you've read about it. Okay. So, when I say the idea of Mantoyat, so people ask me that it's been 6 years. Aren't you bored of Manto? Like, isn't it exhausting? Like, you ask the same question. You have to say the same thing. The reason I don't get bored is because of that Mantoyat. What I feel when I say Manto is not just the man and the writer, but the idea. And when I say the idea, it is that what I said earlier, this will to be more honest, this will to be more outspoken, this will to stick your neck out even when you think there are dangers, but you believe in it so much that you feel it's worth doing it. I think these days we have so few convictions, you know, that what are the things that we would really want to give our lives for? After all, today, if we are in a free democratic country, it's because hundreds, thousands, millions of people gave their lives for it. The Gandhis and the Nehrus and the Sardar Patels, we know the name, but there were many, many others who kind of, you know, just believed in something and gave their lives for it. So today we don't do that. And it's not that there are any less problems today. The enemy is not a Gora, but, you know, there are so many things that are going wrong with our country. I was just reading an article that we have our health, we devote from our budget 1.3%, which is a minuscule amount, right, of our entire budget. And today we're fighting coronavirus, obviously, because our health system is completely broken. It's one of the lowest in the world. So what are our priorities? And yet we are not engaged enough. So I think Manto, when I say the idea of Manto, is that desire to engage, to care, to live a life with conviction. I think that's why it fascinates me. That's why it motivates me. That's why it inspires me.
And one more thing I want to ask you here. How did you deal with the censorship issue in the movie?
Well, I act like I was Manto because I had an argument with the censor board for over 2 hours. And I told them that I think it's like I'm in a house and I'm fighting for Manto. And the way they were fighting for Manto, they were fighting for Manto. Don't cut these words. This is language. And I had not even done anything that was in any way sexual or anything violent. In fact, I myself don't like to see violence in films. And I don't know if it's because of a female gaze or my own personal gaze. Both my films are set in violent times, but both do not really have violence in the film. I always find other ways to show the trouble, the fear, the violence, you know, and no blood and gore. So we fought almost, not fought, but we argued for almost 2 hours. They had 22 points, which got reduced to 4 audio cuts. So I had 4 things that I had to beep. They told me I could put another word. And I said, no, I don't want to put another word. I want the audience to know that you have beeped them. So let there be a silence. Let it be muted. But I'm not going to put another word. So, but I still think it was a victory in many ways that they didn't at least cut any visuals or anything. So it was just 4 audio cuts.
Thank you. I have one more question.
Thank you, Shweta.
I'm so sorry. I'll have to cut you in between. I'm so sorry about that. One more question. We really need to take that. I'm so sorry.
Yeah, I'm nice seeing you all. Thanks, Shweta.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
We have Sangeeta ji here from London. Sangeeta Datta. Sangeeta.
Oh,
can you hear us?
I know one Sangeeta Datta very well. I don't know if that, and she lives in London. Are you the Sangeeta Datta?
I think I'm the Sangeeta Datta, you know well. How are you?
Can't see you.
I'm very good. I can't see you, but I can hear you. I'm good, Sangeeta.
Yeah, hi, and congratulations on the book, Nandita.
Thank you. Sangeeta, just so others also know, had hosted me at the LSE, at the London School of Economics, along with the Prabha Khaitan Foundation. And they together had done a session, the BETHAK, what they do is their program. And I had spoken to the students and faculty at LSE about Manto. So yeah, Sangeeta, you've heard many of the things that I've talked about. But now we are here with the book. Manisha, I can't see Sangeeta.
Yeah, because we've lost her, I think. Yeah, I think we've lost her.
Oh, okay.
Well, she's out of the conference altogether. Okay, so one more question that we have right here from Shruti Mittal. She's from Bangalore. It says, what is your opinion about the slight change in gender roles? Were there any tipping points?
So what is, if you what is the, sorry, say that again, Manisha, your voice was a bit garbled.
What is your opinion brought about the slight change in gender roles? Were there any tipping points? I'm not too sure. Shrutiji, if you're here, could you please like raise your hand so that we can get a clearer picture of the answer?
Are you there, Shruti?
She's here.
She's here? Okay. So, yeah. Well, I mean, there are many tipping points that changes the narrative. It's never one particular thing. And often it is not some Jhansi Ki Rani that changes things. It's just regular, what we call ordinary women who make different choices, who cross the threshold, who do something that nobody has done before, who speak up, who, you know, try out a different profession that they haven't, who question things. They are the ones who very gradually do that. I mean, today, if you and I are able to talk and work and do many of the things that we do, is because many other women have opened those doors for us. Sure. So I don't know if there is one tipping point, but I do think that, for instance, when Bhavri Devi's case happened, you know, in some sense, here was a woman, a village woman, an illiterate woman who came out and talked about her gang rape. And I think in some sense, that was a tipping point. But was it a tipping point enough? If her case is still pending in High Court after 20 years and she's still not got justice, you know, while Nirbhaya's case, which happened, which was again a kind of a tipping point because everyone sort of gathered around it. But again, it was not the first or the last case. I mean, there were many cases, as we know, after that and many before. So the tipping points also, sadly, we keep normalizing them.
True.
You know, which is really a pity. But I feel each one of us can be that person to make those small changes and inspire the our circle of influence, because everybody has a circle of influence. If we make different choices, if we become more courageous, we are bound to impact the other women, the other men around us and create that change. So we shouldn't wait for that tipping point and, you know, become that ourselves.
Thank you so much, Nanda. That's Shruti here.
Thank you.
You answered my question absolutely well. And I love that little point that you said, that this is when we've changed from, you know, the men in our lives becoming supportive to becoming partners. You know, now they've started realizing that they owe it and they are partners and they're not just outside supporters. So I really appreciate that.
But we are just as influenced. You know, we are just as part of patriarchy as the men are.
So I agree.
Even if they do that much, we think that they're so supportive. Not that we shouldn't give them compliments, but we also should know that we have a long way to go and they have a long way to go.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for you before being you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for joining in and making my afternoon also interesting and stimulating. And also, every time one speaks, one is also reminding oneself of all one has to do. So thank you for that. Thank you, Manisha. And please thank everyone.
Thank you so much. I speak on behalf of everyone present here, I'm sure. We all had a wonderful time. And please stay safe, everyone. And I'm so sorry I couldn't get everyone to answer. Like everyone to question.
And let's also, if I can make a little appeal, that let's also the help out. We are safe. We can afford to do social distancing, but there are many who can't. So let's also help, migrant laborers, daily wages. There are many organizations. I'm sure there are organizations in your city. If you Google, you'll find there is Give India Foundation. There is Goonj.org. And there are many other organizations, local organizations that are doing. Let's make that effort and do something for others. I think this coronavirus has taught us that our lives are so deeply interlinked that we can't be safe if others are not safe. But let's extend that and, you know, become more compassionate and caring. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.